This is The Artist's Response with Elizabeth Stewart, and you're welcome to join us. Please stay tuned for a program produced by Richard Dugan and researched and presented by Elizabeth Stewart, who welcomes the great artists of our community. What follows is a conversation of an artist's experience about the artist's response to trying times, creativity, reinvention, recovery, and of course, flexibility, which is in fact the narrative of our present
time.
3, 2, 1,
you're live.
Hello, 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 Santa Barbara. It's your chantress of everything valuable and beautiful, Elizabeth Stewart. I am celebrating, I cannot believe this, 20 years of the annual Open Studios Tour is happening this Labor Day weekend. And the lineup is super impressive. There's 28 artists, the studios are open. It's the largest event of its kind on the Central Coast. And this year it's benefiting the Santa Barbara Food Bank, which is a wonderful, wonderful association. So all through Labor Day. So if you're listening tonight, it's 8 to 27. What you can do is start to plan ahead. Take a look at the Santa Barbara Open Studios Tour website, and you'll see that there's a couple buttons to click on, how you get your tickets, et cetera. But the fun thing is that they're going to be open September 4th and the 5th, all the studio tours, 28 of them, from 11 till 5. And then that would be Saturday and Sunday. And then Monday from 11 till 2. The Friday night previous, so what would that be, the September 3rd, I think. Friday night previous is going to be a reception at CAW, CAW, for the artists. And, you know, that, dear listener, that is so much fun because the artists are there. They're kind of ensconced in front of their pieces, or they're talking amongst their other friends in front of some other piece. You can meet the artist. You can actually see who the artist is. You can ask them about their work, et cetera. And if you go to the opening reception, you can sort of start to think about where you want to travel the next 2 days and see who you want to see. So it's an unprecedented event of its kind on the Central Coast. It's been going on for 20 years, started with just a handful of artists. Richard and I have been covering this event for 13 years every year. And we try hard to get everybody on. And this hour, we're going to be talking with two artists, and I'm really thrilled to introduce our two artists. Cheryl Doty is, fascinating. She started as a graphic artist because she started a sign design company. And I had to laugh because she's done large installations for Nike and Nordstrom, and then O'Hare International Airport. Who knew? That was my growing up, that was the airport that I used. You know, I grew up in Chicago, et cetera. Rosemont, Illinois. I've seen this actually, Cheryl, the giant rose on a water tower there. I mean, it's amazing. God, it's been years, but I was blown away when I read that in your resume. So, you know, this is a woman who's had a life in the arts, and because the past 10 years or so, a little bit of a change. Cheryl's actually gone back to actually study two-dimensional work. And I had an opportunity to look at her website. It's very interesting, evocative, sort of expressionistic work, but large scale and very bold indeed. Pamela Benham is here. I can't even tell you the kind of background Pamela's had. She was trained at the very famous Art Students League in New York City, went on to Cooper Union, and then ended up her education at the École des Beaux-Arts in Paris. And the many awards and grants and scholarships. Some of the important ones, just to pick out a couple, but she painted in the New York City in the Art Students League under a Ford Foundation grant and a Reginald Marsh scholarship. And then, of course, she's going to talk a little bit, because I prepped her just a few minutes ago to talk a little bit about some of her teachers. Some of her teachers are you know, incredibly famous artists. And then just to finalize Pamela's resume, before we start to talk with these two wonderful artists who are both on the studio tours. Pamela's exhibited in museums and galleries such as the Musée d'Art Moderne, Musée du Luxembourg, all both in Paris. She's had 20 solo exhibitions in galleries in New York, including, Miller, Susan Schreiber, Jane Baum, et cetera. 30 exhibitions, including Monmouth Museum. I'm very familiar with them. My mom grew up not far from there, Rochester Contemporary Arts Center, Attleboro Arts Museum, and then here in Santa Barbara, you may have seen her at the Westmont Ridley Tree Museum of Art. She was represented by Sullivan Goss and Gray Space, et cetera. And she's got a name for her studio where she paints. It's called the Art House Studio here in Santa Barbara. So a long career, fruitful career in the arts, fantastic. Now, before we launch into talking with the two fantastic artists today, what I've asked them to do is to sort of visually paint a picture of their process, because the idea is that you're going to be let into these studios and you're going to see the material evidence of how an artist works. But I want to spend a little time this, you know, half hour, 40 minutes with these artists about how they actually get into that headspace. So you're going to see their material space, but now we're going to sort of presage that by talking a little bit about their headspace. So I would like to start with Cheryl and talk a little bit. Cheryl Doty is here. Talk a little bit about your studio. What are people going to see, and what don't they see, Cheryl?
Okay. Well, thank you very much for having me, and it's this wonderful opportunity. I wanted to get into, since we're sitting here and it's a blank canvas, basically, because we don't see the studio, to walk through, for me, on a daily basis, I am really, I'm a person that really likes my environment. So all my life, I've been chasing environment through my companies that I had, the three companies that I had in the graphic design business. My offices had to be open space, well-designed, lots of windows. So when you walk into my studio, the beginning of the building is an atrium that has very, you know, big boulders, and it's quiet, zen. You walk up the steps, and my studio is all open glass doors that go, it's inside outside feeling. So this way I have a sense of good energy. And that's how I did it when I had my corporation, and that's how I'm doing it as an artist. And that's how I live, is my environment. That's all I've done all my life, is strive to get that, no matter what consequences. So in my studio, it's concrete floors, rough texture walls, and my art is spread out around all four walls. It has an ambiance of calm. A lot of my paintings have organic feelings of florals, but abstract florals, vegetation, a lot of landscape, but it's more like a dreamy. It's more dreamy than it is realistic.
Yeah, I got that. You know, it's so interesting you talk about the environment being like a springboard for you. I'm reflecting on just a picture entered my mind as you were talking about your studio. And by the way, I'm seeing behind you a beautiful rough stone fireplace Because of course we're on Zoom, dear listener, and I'm seeing like a carriage door, cross beam carriage door with hand hammered iron strap work, et cetera. So the attention to the environment and a beautiful vase of flowers. Richard knows I over the pandemic, Cheryl, I jumped off a cliff and I bought a cabin on Lake Arrowhead to restore. And, you know, it was like, I have the money, I don't have the time, but I'm going to just jump and do this. Well, the cabin has that kind of stone fireplace, and it was built in 1932.
Fantastic.
And it's got all pine wood paneling. And I hired a guy to refinish the paneling. When I got there, he painted it all white. So right now I'm in the process of straying.
Oh, that's great. Well, this is George Knapp's old hunting lodge. This
is
the George Knapp estate property. And this, I bought the hunting lodge and it's been restored. I've cleaned it up. I've had it for 22 years.
So not only are people going to see your gorgeous art, and yes, I think dreamy is a really cool descriptive from what I was researching, but they're going to see a really historic property as well. That's the advantage of the studio tours, because, you know, artists tend to be visually keyed. So you'll see some really interesting studios, I guarantee it. Richard's giving us a break sign, so we've got a quick break. Pamela's going to talk to us a little bit about her process and her space when we get back from the break. Just to reintroduce, I'm celebrating the 20th, number 20 annual studio tour, open studios. Yes, 28 artists, largest of its kind on our coast, benefiting the food bank. Sponsors include CAW and KCLU, as well as the food bank. So very worthy cause. September 4th, 5th, and 6th, with the opening reception on the 3rd at CAW CAW. So don't turn that down. We'll be back in a minute with these two wonderful artists representing two of the 28 that are going to be showing and opening their studios, and in some cases their homes, to the public. A great leap of faith in these days, by the way. Mm-hmm. So anyway, let's talk a little bit with Pamela when we get back from the break. Hey, Richard.
Yes, Elizabeth.
Let's go to break. And how are you?
I am doing fantastic, doing great. My health is, I'll be honest with you, I feel like it's perfect.
Yeah, Richard went through a very serious, very sudden operation a couple of weeks ago, just whisked him away. So we're so happy that he's back. Anyway,
so am I.
Yeah, I bet. Pamela's going to tell us about her process when we get back. Don't turn that down.
All right, you are clear. Very good. Yeah, they ripped out my gallbladder and the gallstone that was the size
What's
of a
that?
Golf ball.
This?
And I believe they
newest
found a
online
putter
business banking around.
Well.
Can you initiate wires and approve transfers?
Yes.
Pay bills.
Check.
Cash management.
Okay.
All right, we're doing great, Elizabeth. Sounding good.
Yeah. So, no, seriously, Cheryl, I paid a whole bunch of money to have the entire pine paneling stripped. It had, you know, had varnish shellac, beeswax, varnish shellac for 90 years. And then I walk in and it's like whitewashed, you know, the entire house is.
Oh
yeah. And it was so amusing because my son, who's in his early 30s, he recently had my first grandchild, and they were going to come up and take a look at the newly refinished walls. So I had walked in with my partner John, and we'd actually both like been totally dumbfounded. And then I forgot that my son and daughter-in-law were, you know, kind of on their way up from San Diego where they live. And I had some nice clothes on. I don't know where we were before, but I took all my clothes off. I was buck naked. And I said to John, grab me my belt sander. And here I am naked with the belt sander working on the, and the kids walk in.
Wow.
I will tell you that in the house that we had in Phoenix, Elizabeth, we had one of those beehive fireplaces that was in the corner. And we actually, I kid you not, and it did have red brick, which we did not paint, but all of the other like plaster surfaces on the outside of the beehive, we painted it purple and it looked very cool.
Well, you know, we are coming back.
Stand by in 3, 2, 1. You're live.
Welcome back. It's Elizabeth Stewart. We're celebrating 20 years of the annual Open Studios Tour here in Santa Barbara. 28 artists this year. Studios are going to be open. Homes are going to be open. You're going to see how an artist lives in many cases, or at least how an artist's studio is set up. And we talked a few minutes ago with Cheryl Doty, who is opening her studio in I learned here that it's a famous landmark here in Santa Barbara. So that's double whammy for you to see a gorgeous place and a gorgeous studio and gorgeous art as well. Pamela, what is Art House Studio? What is that like?
Well, unlike Cheryl's, mine is a place to make a mess. It's a converted garage, 20 by 20, and it's all my, I paint very, very intensely at a high energy. And you asked how do we get into the mind shift to be able to paint? I always start by turning on music and then start dancing, moving, you know, to get out of my head and more into the doing. And then I'll start singing too, to kind of get my chi energy up and get things moving. And you know, I use the music of like Linda Ronstadt or Aretha Franklin, so I can really belt it out. And then I paint on the floor. So the floor is a canvas with the canvas sitting on top of it. So you have all the remains, all of the archaeological layers that are all around the painting that I do on the floor. But one thing that's interesting, so then I start and I just throw some color onto the canvas and then just be in reaction and interaction with that color. And people have come into my studio and said, it's so organized because, you know, where I paint, I can make a mess, but everything else is absolutely where I can grab it. So I don't interrupt the flow, because the entire purpose is to be in the flow, paint intensely, and not be in the thinking mode where you're going, uh-oh, I've got to go pick up some milk at the grocery store on the way home. You know, I don't think at all about the past or the future, just absolute focus. And I love that state. So it's yay, you know, I get to go there when I paint. And it's sort of moving from a trained artist intuition, where I've painted realistically and I presently paint abstractly. And all of that practice, I've painted for more than 50 years, and all that practice comes out as automatic reactions and responses, and very, very little thinking goes on. Like I might say, oh, needs more red. That'll be the thought that comes to mind. You know, otherwise it's just movement, painting, more movement. And it's my favorite state.
So can you talk a little bit about your teachers? I mean, you've got some incredible teachers in your past.
Yeah, well, I studied drawing at Art Students League with Nathaniel Beverly Hale, which now I saw recently in the Faulkner Gallery. This guy was sitting there reading his book, you know, so he's sort of this, a lot of people refer to him as a way to learn anatomy. So I studied anatomy. I studied with Paul Resica and Leland Bell at Cooper Union, Paul Resica was mainly a landscape artist. So I sort of moved into impressionist landscapes at that point of my career. And also with Dori Ashton, who was an extraordinary critic, and I got to study with her, and she led a class at Cooper. And then when I went to Paris and studied at the École des Beaux-Arts, I studied with Pierre Caron, and he really taught me to see, you know, it's interesting what everyone gives you, but for me, he really brought me to see edges and what sharp edges and soft focus edges overlap. I started thinking much more in relation to how to create space, and that's carried over to my abstract work as well.
And then, not to mention 1984 to 1985, you worked with Claes Oldenburg.
Yeah, that was a great experience. It was a Swiss Army knife and the burnt match. The Swiss Army knife, I ran a crew of six artists that we finished it, meaning making it smooth. We did the finish work. And then we installed it in pieces at the Guggenheim Museum. And I came in and painted it. I was the final painter of that piece. And then he had me work on this piece called The Burnt Match, and he hired me to paint it as well. What I found was interesting with him was he's very, very quiet, very much of an introvert. You know, if you got three words out of him, maybe it was just the circumstance, but he didn't speak much at all. And he just had this gentle demeanor. It was very sweet.
And I want to ask Cheryl, you know, I know this is way back in your past, but Cheryl, what did you do for O'Hare International Airport?
I did the signage program for the entire Delta terminal. So that means all the signs, if you're to walk through the Delta terminal today, the signs my company had manufactured and installed.
So I know it well. Yeah. That's fantastic. Richard's giving us a sign we got to go to quick break. When we get back from the break, I want to talk a little bit about the kind of work that you'll be showing on the studio tour. You know, maybe there's a canvas or two that you can describe, kind of whet people's appetites to come. And also, you know, maybe talk a little bit about if things are going to be for sale, what things you're going to have for sale, if any. And we'll kind of discuss that so people kind of get an idea that, you know, this is an opportunity. By the way, I have to say, Pamela and Carol, so many of my clients, you know, they're so sick of their walls. They've been saying, oh, Elizabeth, sell this, sell that, sell this. I can't stand this anymore. Who, you know, why have I been looking at this for 40 years? I can't take it. You know, so many people are just so tired of their walls right now because that's what they've been seeing for 18 months. So this is a great opportunity. The studio tours just like redo some walls here with some real talent. Okay, Richard, let's go to Richard.
Yes, Elizabeth, I'm right here.
Let's go to a quick break. We get back from the break. We're going to talk a little bit about what you guys out there might have an opportunity to purchase, reinvigorate your own walls with some of this great opportunity. The Open Studio Tours, September 4th, 5th, and 6th. The opening is September 3rd, in which you can meet the artist, in which you can get an idea of who you want to visit the next 3 days. Don't turn that dial. Back in a minute with Pamela and Cheryl. Great.
All right, you are clear, and I've got a bunch of people in the waiting room. Are you expecting more people?
Yeah, so we're going to do a double, Richard. So at about 10:40, we're going to switch gears. Pamela and Cheryl are going to go, and then we have the next crew. It's a kind of a world premiere theater event. That's the cast that's coming in. So
I've got Shelley, Jordana, Gull, and Claudia in the waiting room.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, you've got them all.
All right, very good. Very good. Just checking.
Yeah. And you guys, have you found it's been easier or harder to work during the pandemic?
Easier.
Yeah, I find it easier because you don't have all the activity from social activity. So there's a lot of downtime. So it's better it's not better. In the beginning, it wasn't better. In the beginning, it was really depressing. So my paintings turned out that way.
Yeah.
Quiet.
So, you know, I have a number, a lot of my friends are practicing career artists, and one particular super talented friend of mine is plein air painter. Mm-hmm. He's with, you know, one of the founders of, well, he was his teacher, Ray Strong, you know, and it was a Oak Group originator, et cetera. And so plein air, you know, down to his cotton socks. And so he's found it difficult to paint, because when he goes out, he sees people kind of on, you know, in the places he goes out to, you know, pretty wild places. He goes out there and, you know, he'll see people just kind of trying to get away from this reality. And it you know, how you guys, how you artists, he feels it on a deeper level.
All and right, so here we go.
Yes.
In 3, 2, 1, you're live.
Welcome back. It's Elizabeth Stewart. I'm speaking with Cheryl Doty and Pamela Benham. They are two studio artists, career artists, all their lives, many, many years of painting behind both of them. They are going to be opening their studios in the 20th annual Open Studios Tour coming up this Labor Day weekend. 28 artists. You have an opportunity to visit as many as you want. And I wanted to ask Cheryl a little bit about what she's going to be showing in her own beautiful walls, and if they're going to be for sale. Cheryl.
My work will all be for sale, and the full body of work is about fabric, Belgian linen that I painted on with paint, oil paints. And it has a feeling of translucent, where it has the linen showing and the paint and the subject, which is primarily organics. So I wanted it to be a feeling of nature, fabric, and quiet. And I think it's probably quiet because most all the pieces are quiet, based on the COVID experiences that we've been through for the last, feels like 2 years now. So it's very calming when you go in. It'll be, there's subjects like places that I've been in Morocco, hiking in Morocco. So I've got a painting called Morocco. I have the Lotus Land Wall, which is representation of the Lotus Land Wall. There'll be iceberg roses, which we all know iceberg roses are Santa Barbara. Africa rainstorm. I have paintings from Africa from travels after a rainstorm. So it's primarily into nature, and they are all oils. They're large scale. Most of them are priced at about anywhere from 3,000 to up to 5. And then I have smaller scale, a lot smaller scale with portraits and more traditional, which is a smaller scale version. So it's a different twist than,
you know, even when you're talking about it, it calms me down. So I think that's fantastic. That's Pamela, good. What are you going to show?
I paint large. 36 by 48 is my favorite size. And they're very, they're abstract, very expressive. For me, the entire reason for painting is to express emotions. So they tend to be bright colors. This is a little corner. Oh, I forgot. You guys don't see the Zoom, but I have a little corner of one here. I always work with transparent paint, sometimes translucent, but I like the light, like watercolors, I like the light to come from underneath. So my paintings are intense colors, glowing colors. I've always enjoyed that sort of Rembrandt glow, or the, you know, the watercolor glow, that sense that light is coming from underneath. I don't know what else to say. Let's see.
Will things be for sale?
Yes. A few of them are being held for a solo show that I have coming up. and a few proposals for museum shows. So not all of them, but quite a lot. A lot of them will be for sale. And I also have smaller works that will be for sale. And the large ones run between 2,400 and 3,000. And the smaller works are anywhere from 400 up.
And I wonder, Cheryl, if you could just opine a little bit about price point.
Okay.
I mean, if number of younger and less experienced artists may be listening to this, and you know, you might offer them some wisdom about how they can understand what they're, you know, maybe they have aspirations to be on the Open Studios tour. Maybe one of their main conflicts is, well, I'd like to sell, but I don't know what price point. What would you say?
Well, it's very, that's a very loaded question. It's a big one. And I think when you're starting off as an artist, you start pricing your work on a very, you know, a smaller price tag, less money than you think, you know, let's say it starts off at 100. And then if people buy your work at 100, and it's a 12 by 12, then if you've got four people or five people that actually bought at 100, then I think you can raise your price. And so I think price points are gradual. I think you can, just like any product in the market, you can have a price point when you're young and keep it moving up, or even when you're old and keep it moving up the more you sell. And also, when it comes to art, this is a real unfortunate thing, really unfortunate. Everybody wants a discount. Everybody wants a percentage cut. And it's really, you know, you do it as an artist because that's part of the trade, unfortunately. It just goes with the territory. And it is, you do that, and you do it for friends and you do it for family, for sure. Sometimes you give art away to family and friends, but you definitely discount to friends and family. I mean, I have. And also, if you're not paying a gallery direct, you're able to discount because the gallery is usually taking 50%. So price points come up as you go up in pricing in your art. So that's how I.
That's wise counsel. Yeah. Well, I just want to just give another little shout out to the Open Studios Tour. We're going to take a break and then we're going to segue to a number of thespians and a really important play that's opening in town when we get back from the break. But just so y'all know that the Open Studios Tour is an opportunity to redo your house, redo your walls, take a look at some of our best artists in our town, 20th annual Open Studios Tour. You will never look at a painting the same again when you see the inside of a studio. You really won't. This, I guarantee you, if you have not seen a professional artist at work, this will change your idea of how you look at art. So it's an opportunity to see 28 artists, largest of its kind on the Central Coast, benefiting the Santa Barbara Food Bank, CAW, KCLU, et cetera, September 4th, 5th, and 6th, opening night, September 3rd. You can meet Pamela Benham when you go. You can meet Cheryl Doty when you go. You can meet 26 other artists on these tours. And I can't tell you how fun they are, really, and how obliging and how open these artists are. I mean, every year, Pamela and Cheryl, I do this interview, and one year this artist, young artist, was, I can't clean enough. I just can't organize enough. I can't bake enough cookies. She was so excited to have the public come in. So it's an opportunity to actually see how the artists as people are and what their environments are like, as Cheryl was saying. So great opportunity. Hey, Richard.
Go ahead, Elizabeth.
All right, so let's go to a quick break. And when we get back from the break, I want to introduce a a wonderful lineup. Claudia Hogue McGarry is here. She's a writer, director, producer. She wrote a new play called Breaking the Code, which is actually very outside of her oeuvre. I've covered her for a while, and I want to talk about her new play. And she's actually pulled together some of her actors. So we're going to be joined by some of the actors when we get back from the break, talk a little bit about Breaking the Code. Don't turn that dial. Back in a minute. Thank you, Pamela. Thank you, Cheryl. Good luck on the tour. I'll see you there.
Thank you. Thanks for having me. Should we...
You are clear.
Should we leave? Should we get out?
Yeah, you can leave or you can stick around and listen to the actors. But yeah, you can jump off if you'd like. And I'll send you the link. I'll send Francis and you guys the link to this.
Thank you. Thanks so much. That's great.
Oh, yeah. It was great to meet you, too.
So nice to meet you.
Oh, wonderful. Thank you so much. It was great.
Yes.
Bye.
Take care. Bye-bye.
Let's go. I see go. If Claudia's coming on, there's Jordana, there's Shelley. Okay, excellent. There's Claudia. Hi, Claudia. Nice to see you, Claudia. Oh, you're on mute. Claudia's on mute. Gull's on mute.
There, is it okay?
Yeah, hey, Claudia.
Hi, how are you?
So I'm gonna introduce the show a little bit, and I'll introduce all you guys, and then I want Claudia to tell us a little bit about why this play is different from her other plays. And romantic comedy is I think necessary in these trying times. So maybe you could talk a little bit about that. But
yeah, so that's one reason I did a romantic comedy. First of all, I love.
Well, now wait, Claudia, wait till Richard gives us a sign. He's still
working it out.
I think he's on commercial break right now. Looks like, yeah.
Yes, Elizabeth.
Okay, so are you ready?
We're not ready to start yet. I'll give you the cue.
Okay, so let me introduce you guys, Claudia, and then you take it over as to the idea of the romantic comedy and how this is, I think, is sort of a nice antidote to our lives these days.
So, okay.
3, 2, 1, you are live.
Welcome back. It's Elizabeth Stewart. We're talking with Claudia McGarry, and she's a friend of mine who is a writer and director, and she's always thinking of new things to do, and she's thought that we need a romantic comedy, and so she's bringing to the stage a romantic comedy called Breaking the Code. To celebrate that, we've got a number of her actors with us today. I have Gul Saeed, who's the lead actor in this. Born in Pakistan, his training is in biochemistry. He's at UCSB right now, but he loves the theater, and he grew up exploring the classical music genre of South Asian music, and he's a prize winner in that actual field. But he's probably not going to be a thespian professionally. He's probably going to go into medicine professionally. So very interesting gentleman. Shelley Best is here. She's a mother, she's an actress, and she's been a foster mom to 6 children through the years. We have seen her in commercials and films. She's been not on the boards for 30 years, but doing a lot of work behind the camera. And now she's gonna return to the theater. Jordana Lawrence is the director. She's, I believe, worked for Claudia for a number of productions. I've seen her name with a lot of Claudia's productions. She's worked at the Center Stage, the Garvin Theater. She's been a house manager. If you don't know what a house manager is, it's the worst job in the entire world. You know, I was in ballet for years and years, and our house managers were, I mean, like, you dancers are so stupid. You have no idea. I mean, it's a really tough job. She's directed 11 shows for the Alcazar and Carpinteria. Her family have all been involved in film. and theater, and all her siblings and parents have been writers, directors, and producers, and what a house to grow up in. And she, I think this marks her third time working for Claudia. Hey, Claudia, very quickly, because I want to talk with each of the performers and the director. So very quickly, why a romantic comedy?
So I think I just wanted something uplifting, multi-generational and multicultural. And I wanted to see how I did with writing comedy. I'd only done it once before in a screenplay that my friend Sheila and I wrote called Dying to Meet You. And so I was really excited to try to do it in a play format.
And Shelley, now you're back in the theater. How do you feel?
I love it. Acting, the energy is great. In the theater, there's a lot more memorizing than there is on film in snippets. So, but it's great. It's great fun. It's a break from my everyday work. So I'm thrilled to be there.
What's it like working with Gull?
It's fantastic. He has made this production for me. It's been very welcoming, very easy to work with, very accommodating, sweet, kind, amazing person in another country doing a play in another language. It's amazing.
Go, what do you have to say about that?
I love it. When I started doing it, I wasn't sure that I would be able to do it. Claudia helped me, and then Shelley helped me after that, and she has been very supportive. And I just have admiration for her.
So what, as far as your singing and musical career in the past, has that helped in the production that you're going to perform in this time?
Absolutely, absolutely. I have loved singing, and right now, singing, when you sing and when you get on the stage for the first time, then you kind of get that confidence, and that confidence never goes away. And now I was feeling like I was at home in the stage. So I love it.
Georgiana, what's it like to direct Shelley and Gull?
Oh, it's been great fun. You know, I mean, to see the chemistry, to see their progression as the weeks have gone on in the rehearsal period, it's been terrific.
So do you think you're ready for opening?
Absolutely.
Yeah, I only asked because, you know, I danced for many years, and it seemed that when we were mounting a production, it was always chaos until the last like 15 minutes, and then it magically came together. Nobody knew what they were doing for, you know, 6 months of rehearsal. Then all of a sudden, the last 15 minutes, everybody knew what they were doing. So do you have that experience?
I think that's still the case, but I think if you've got the experience and you've done shows, you can see it coming together prior to that, because there are usually moments that you see and that gives you the confidence to say, okay, this is gonna work. You know, Ron Howard said that 90% of directing is getting the right cast. And when you do that, it helps with whatever comes afterwards, because you know in the end, the cast is going to pull it off.
I want to talk just to Claudia. The multi-generational thing is really important in this piece. You've got a lot of different generations working. And I know, you know, you have a family as well. And your family is, they're all creatives as well. So speak to me about the multi-generational theme.
Well, I have twin sons that are 35, and so I wanted to have a son character kind of in that age range. And I like the idea of two different ages kind of meeting and connecting. I don't think there's anything wrong with that, and different cultures meeting and connecting. I had taught at City College for over 30 years, and I had students from all countries. So I kind of wanted to bring that out in my writing a little bit too, all that experience. But to talk about what you asked about things coming together. Yeah, it's been such an education for me to do full productions now, because I've always done readings. Oh, I've sometimes done readings in the past. And full productions are a lot more complicated because of tech and lighting and you know, the logistics of everything, it's a lot harder to pull off. And all of these guys, Goal and Shelley and Jordana, have been amazing. The whole cast has been just very warm and wonderful.
So before we run out of, we've got about 10 minutes or so, and I want to talk a little bit about why the generational thing works so well in this play. And, you know, the love interest in regards to the generational, I think that's a really interesting thing that you've done with this play, Claudia. So I want to talk about that. But before I forget, this is Breaking the Code. I'm talking with the cast, the director and the writer. And if you are interested, August 28th at Center Stage Theater, 3 and 7 p.m., tickets are available at the Center Stage website. And then it goes to the Namba Theater for the Performing Arts in Ventura, August 29th at 3 p.m. It is an uplifting piece, and it's going to have some resonance for people. I mean, I was reading a little bit about the play, and I was thinking how interesting, you know, my son's father is a Scot and has houses in Scotland and in this country. And that cross-generational romance that we had over the years, he's still my best friend. You know, it's a really fruitful thing to explore. So when we get back from the break, I wonder if you talk a little bit about that. Hey, Richard.
Yes, Elizabeth.
Okay, quick break, and then we're going to come back. Claudia's going to tell us a little bit about what we're kind of hinting around about, what's the interesting generational pull in this piece. And she will disclose all when we get back from the break. Don't turn that dial. Back in a minute.
All right, you're clear. And basically what you're saying is she's going to tell us what the hell they're doing with all this stuff here.
Oh. Yeah, and I can see where Gull is probably a gorgeous singer. What a voice you have, Gull. Your voice is so beautiful.
Thank you.
No, really, Jordana, we had our house manager, his name was Rue. I'll never forget him. And Rue would be, okay, I see you are lazy dancers. Go out and pick up the cigarette butts. I mean, he was a butt kicker. And you know, and then he had to, so we had this, we're on break so nobody can hear, so I can tell you, we had a prima donna choreographer from Paris, and he came to they call it mount a dance on us. Mm-hmm. And so he came to do this, and he was a well-known prima donna. And he sauntered in, I was with the Pittsburgh Ballet Theater, he sauntered into Heinz Hall opening night, and he had tight leather pants on and a beautiful Angora white sweater, and we weren't doing something right. And in the middle of the performance, you know, there's like 1,000 people, he stands up and he's angry. The house manager had to calm him down. You know, what the house manager does, well, he ended up in jail for making a huge, you know, outbreak in the theater. The police had to come. He ended up in jail in his leather pants. And then the house manager had to go bail him out of jail. I mean, what the house manager, that was Rue. So I can tell you stories about house management, at least from the dance, you know, from the ballet side. Unbelievable what you guys do.
But I think it's the same for any form that's whatever's performing. The audience is where.
All right, stand by. We are coming back, and you have 5 minutes. In 3, 2, 1, you're live.
Welcome back. It's Elizabeth Stewart. I'm talking about a new play by one of our very talented writers here in town, Claudia Hogue McGarry. She wrote a play called Breaking the Code, and the secret behind the play is, yes, it's cross-cultural. Gul Saeed plays one of the love interests. Shelley Best plays the lead actress and love interest. And the interesting thing is there is a generational difference and there is a cultural difference. So Claudia, talk a little bit about that.
Okay. Well, I mean, by the time you're older, like I am, you know, you've seen different generations go through different phases, and this generation of young people is very different than my generation was. The money's very different, the stresses are different, but in some ways things are very much the same. Some things never change. So I just kind of wanted to have the different relationships and show how each character is struggling with something from their own perspective. So, you know, Ghoul being the young man is enthusiastic, and but he's sort of taking his time to figure out what he wants to do with his life. Shelley has already led in her character of Christy has already led a very full life. She's had a few tragic setbacks and now she's trying to move forward. Ghoul's mother is from Pakistan originally in the play. And she's got some big hurdles to overcome. She just wants her sons to grow up and have good careers and be happy. And then the sister character played by Heather Turbell is a person who has had big disappointments in her life and she's trying to have hope for the future. So they each have something that's kind of holding them back, but also pushing them forward. And they all come together in a way that helps them move forward. So that's why the name of it is Breaking the Code.
So Go, what is your relationship with Shelley in the play?
It is a relationship of a lover. I fall in love with her as soon as we meet for the first time. And but I am hesitant because of cultural expectations. And I am, at the same time, I don't want my mother to get hurt as well. So some things are pulling me back and desires are pushing me forward. So I am in that kind of struggle. It's a relationship of struggle.
And Shelley, what's your relationship with Gull?
I'm very hesitant. You know, I'm a 50-year-old playwright who's, you know, as Claudia mentioned, had a lot of tragedy and loss and just have kind of been living in my own world. And here comes this, you know, young, attractive Pakistani who sweeps me off my feet and I fall head over heels, but am concerned about, you know, what people will think and what my daughter will think and how it will fit in my world. So,
and what does your daughter think?
Well, I don't know how much I want to reveal.
Spoiler.
I think that, you know, in the end, it's all about, I mean, there's a lot of acceptance. There's a lot of people coming to terms with the struggles that they have dealt with in their own life and realizing that everyone's going through struggles. So, you know, ultimately, I think we all become very accepting of what's happening in each other's world.
Claudia, we only have like a few minutes, but to tell me where you found Gull.
I think, was it Craigslist, Gull?
No, Facebook. It was on Facebook.
Oh, okay. Okay, so I had posted on Santa Barbara Theater Collaborative, and I had posted on, believe it or not, Craigslist. And at first I hardly got any responses. And then after we found Ghoul, I got so many men that wanted to try out, but their timing was off. And I was so happy because we found Ghoul. So
right, I can imagine. What a find. Fantastic.
I also wanted to mention Sherry Howard and Marlene Matosian, because the two of them play the Ghoul's mother and then Shelley or Christy's daughter. And they're really good.
Well, thank you all, and I'll be there at the opening. Congratulations.
Thank you.
And you are clear.
Okay, so Claudia, I'll send you the link. Once you get the link, you own it.